tree. And I'm on my knees beside them, rocking and sobbing myself. But there's nothing I can do. I'm useless, and I know it. Forget me, his mother, or anyone else. Balthazar is alone. But worse, so much worse than that, is what he knows in his heart. He knows that this is his fault. All of it. It's his fault for being so innocent. For teaching a little boy how to steal. For being a bad example to a good soul. And he knows that some unseen power is punishing him for what he's done with his own life. All of the unforgivable sins he's committed. He knows that God hates him. Here is proof in his arms. What God could do this? Only a God who hates. And smooth, singular purpose washes over him. He's dead now. There are no more consequences in life. He's dead. And the dead have license to kill the living. He's dead, and God hates him. Here's the proof. Right here, bleeding into his lap. But Balthazar won't settle for being hated by God. He'll hate God right back.
Three. Sela stopped in mid-sentence. The desert had grown almost completely dark, but she could feel Balthazar standing over her. She looked up, and there he was, looming over the two sitting women and their tear-streaked faces. Silhouetted against the last of the pale sky and the first stars to welcome the night. Go on. Don't stop there. Sela tried to tell herself she didn't care for the others. But she couldn't help but feel a little shame. She still cared enough to feel a twinge of guilt. Over having betrayed something so deeply personal. Go on, he said again, in a tone that sounded less like a suggestion than more like a prayer. Tell her, he said. Tell her what happened. See what's on.
Thank you.
so helpless and trusting, brought the full horror of Sela's story rushing. She imagined the grief that Balthazar's mother must have felt at losing two sons in one day. She imagined the face of the centurion as he squeezed out his Herod met with the riches of such a
understand. You have a shaman traveling with you, said Herod. Some kind of seer.
The Magus.
I very much like to travel.
Fine.
Thank you.
I see quite with every moment. Loud enough to be heard clear across the ravine. Balthazar had been wandering through his own mind a lot of times, trying to sift through his doubts, trying to reconcile what his beliefs told him with what his eyes and ears had been telling him in recent days. It had been a random walk, aimless, inconclusive. But now he reached a point. Either he had to accept dead or beaten, in which case not the matter, there were no consequences, or he had to accept his in which case everything would be evil. And he was probably the first to spend time. Away from a grisly day. And besides, something about the look of the face told me she was thinking. But before he could work on the way, the wail of the approaching dead shook the past away and summoned Balthazar's eyes to the urgent now. Go! He yelled. With the others making their hasty retreat sound behind him, Balthazar turned back to the mass of people's rotten flesh. There were about 40 bodies, less than 50 yards away. He saw one corpse dragging itself along the ground with more yellow fingernails, having lost its legs and lying. Another's torso was horribly twisted, forcing it to move back, which didn't really matter since it didn't have eyes. Thought about this. Nothing would surprise him. Nothing good. But it didn't matter. Even if it meant the most painful hideous death a human being ever experienced, they were revenge. They were shame. 20 years. He gripped the handle of his sword and breathed deep in the desert air. Thank you.
important it was. The good news was, his sword seemed to work just fine. He went to work, chopping away at limbs and guts, hacking away at the leathery skin and hardened seam to help him to death, and trying not to focus on the terrible chemical smell of the warm leather. But the demons dragging him.
Unseen force had smiled down on him at the last possible moment. The Jews called it God's spirit. Whether it was God or luck or something else, it didn't. Did he catch up to me? Take them the rest of the way to Egypt and be done with this. Right out of it. Balthazar looked around, sure that he was about to catch sight of a second wave of rotting beings emerging from their tombs. But there was nothing. Nothing except the rumble. Down the center of the narrow valley. He couldn't see them,
faces of the men on those horses, but he imagined that most of them bore the smug, self-satisfied look of men who pulled off another clever horse. The
rope.
The small horde of men had been replaced with a gigantic horde. It wasn't an improvement. But at least Balthazar knew how to get things right toward him. Once again, he raised his sword and readied himself for a reckless suicide.
Thank you.
when the Magus had completed his slow, mystic return. He doesn't appreciate me. He stepped all the way inside and left the blood cloak. I'm not saying I blame him. Let's be clear about that. It's not an easy thing for a powerful man to mistake in others. Even I do it in self-reliant times. To stop him, it's part of being a leader of men. The Romans have a particular gift for believing themselves superior to everyone. Look at their needs. Even their gods can't help falling in love and getting down. It's obnoxious. He stepped closer, hoping to better gauge the Magus's expression of his plot of arms. There wasn't any time. The Magus remained statuesque. Alone, a king and a conjurer are nothing compared to Rome.